Second World War was significant in seeing the emergence of a number of novel forms of warfare and new weapons and technologies. Not least among these was the marriage of soldier and aircraft to produce the paratrooper. By war's end in 1945, all of the major combatants had employed their own parachute guns to a greater or lesser degree, but it was in Germany that the concept of aerial assault using paratroopers and gliders was pioneered. The success of Germany's Fallschirmjäger and its associated glider units was to have a profound effect on thinking in the United States and Great Britain following the very evident success of this new way of waging war that was used in 1940. Nevertheless, it was the Germans who also first experienced the very obvious limitations of this type of warfare. Following the invasion of Crete in 1941, which, although a German victory, was achieved at such a cost that within less than 2 years of the war beginning, Hitler judged the day of the paratrooper already over. However, the lesson had not been lost on the Allied powers, and from 1941 onwards, they accelerated the development of their own paratroop arms, and all major operations from Operation Torch onwards employed airborne forces. The German paratroop arm, Crete, was to be their first and last strategic operation. And from 1941 until war's end, the Fallschirmjäger arm was committed to battle on the ground as elite infantry. Serving on the Eastern and Western fronts, and finally in 1945 in Germany itself, the Fallschirmjäger arm built themselves an impressive war fighting record. In the pre-Nazi years of the early 30s, when Germany and the Soviet Union had strong military ties, Reichswehr officers first witnessed and were impressed by their use of paratroops. Although Russian methods were crude, the potential of this new approach made a profound impression on the Germans and was taken up in 1935. The notion of troop envelopment from the air, and also the air landing of troops, was seized upon by a number of competing agencies in the new German Wehrmacht. In opposition to the army was the Luftwaffe's Airborne Regiment, which was given official status as part of that new arm in October 1935. The latter held different ideas to the former as to how best use it. However, in the Junkers Ju-52 trimotor, the fledgling paratroop arm was to find the transport that would see it through to the end of the war in 1945. By the beginning of 1936, Hermann Göring had exercised his authority and, by official order, had all the nascent parachute units brought under the wing of the Luftwaffe. This document also provided for the active recruitment of volunteers for the new training school at Stendal and appointment of Generalmajor Kurt Student as head of the new Fallschirmjäger branch of the Luftwaffe. A milestone in the development of the new parachute arm came with the establishment in July 1938 of the 7th Airborne Division under the command of General Student. The distinctive appearance of German paratroops when compared to their later British and American counterparts is already clear. Each paratrooper has no control at all over his descent, the parachute itself being opened by a static line. This was, in its turn, connected to and suspended from the paratrooper by a single harness to the centre of his back. Once he had jumped, he became a victim of the wind and was tossed about during his descent. The actual landing was a shock and numerous injuries were a regular feature. Recruitment received a decided fillip when former German world heavyweight boxing champion Max Schmeling joined the ranks of the Fallschirmjäger. At the time of their appearance at Hitler's birthday parade in Berlin in 1939, the new parachute arm had acquired the organization that would see it through to 1945. Other innovations were gliders to deliver troops and units trained to be airlifted by transports. The idea of air warfare was being rigorously explored, and Student was committed to the ability of his new arm to achieve great things in the event of war. The Fallschirmjäger arm first saw service in the Scandinavian campaign in April 1940. Four companies of paratroops were allocated to capture two airfields in Aalborg in Denmark and two in Norway. While those in Denmark were captured without difficulty, the unit allocated to land and secure the airfield at Oslo found it fog-bound and turned back. Seen here is the 163rd Infantry Division at Stavanger in Norway after it had been captured by the paratroops. The most difficult operation involved a paradrop into the snow-covered Gudbrandsdal Valley 90 miles to the north of Oslo. This operation was less successful, and very strong resistance on the part of the Norwegian defenders forced the Germans, who were cut off from support, to surrender after 4 days. When, during the Polish campaign, Student had complained to Hitler that there was no opportunity to use his new Fallschirmjäger, the German leader assured him that there would be more than enough opportunity for their employment in the forthcoming Western campaign. Indeed, by the time Case Yellow was launched on the 10th of May 1940, the paratroop arm had been allocated a significant and highly visible role in the invasion and defeat of the Low Countries. Unlike in 1914, when the Schlieffen Plan had respected the neutrality of Holland, the plan for the invasion of France and the Low Countries some 26 years later presumed and required the occupation of that country. The offensive began in the early hours of the 10th of May with extensive Luftwaffe airstrikes on Allied airfields throughout the theatre. The achievement of air superiority over northern France, Belgium and particularly Holland was necessary if the carefully laid plans for the airborne assault on specific targets within that country were to succeed. The bulk of the small Dutch air force was caught on the ground and destroyed. The actual conquest of Holland and Belgium had been allocated to Army Group B under the command of Fedor von Bock. In either case, the rapid passage of the mobile formations, deemed to be the decisive factor in securing a rapid victory, turned on the ability of the Fallschirmjäger to seize and secure targets in either country that could impede their offensive. In Holland, these were primarily the major bridges over the Rhine, and in Belgium, the fortress of Ebernemeil. Hitler had revealed his intentions to Student as early as the autumn of 1939 and stressed the vital role that the paratroop arm would play in the forthcoming campaign. In total, 4,000 paratroops from the 7th Flieger Division and 12,000 men from the 22nd Infantry Division were committed by Student on the 10th of May. Two waves, composed of two battalions, were dropped over Dordrecht and Meerdijk in order to secure the bridges. While the Dutch ground forces put up strong resistance, the paratroops, jumping to the north and south of their targets, secured the bridges before they could be blown up. At 6.40 a.m. and under the command of Hauptmann Walter, the 1st Battalion of Fallschirmjäger Regiment 1 jumped from its Ju-52s to attack the bridge at Dordrecht. Under the command of Hauptmann Prager, the 2nd Battalion of Fallschirmjäger Regiment 1 attacked the Meerdijk Bridge. Knowing that it was rigged for destruction, a team led by Lieutenant Tietjen neutralized the explosives, a feat for which he was awarded the Knight's Cross. A vital part of the plan was the rapid capture of a number of airfields by paratroop forces so as to enable them to be used by troops air-landed by the Ju-52s. In a series of assaults launched as part of the 4th Wave, the 3rd Battalion of Fallschirmjäger Regiment 1 was dropped over Rotterdam-Valhaven. Elements of Fallschirmjäger 2 were dropped over Ockenburg and Valkenburg airports. At Valhaven, whose rapid capture was vital to permit the early arrival of the air landing 22nd Division, the paras came under heavy machine gun fire. After an initial firefight, they managed to secure the airport buildings and control tower. The first Ju-52s landed shortly thereafter, with paratroops and infantry fanning out from the base to begin securing the approach routes to Rotterdam. The six companies dropped over Valkenburg were initially successful and secured the base in short order. However, the Dutch recovered and began to counterattack, forcing the Germans onto the defensive. It had been the plan that once landed, the bulk of Major General Graf von Sponeck's 22nd Infantry Division would drive rapidly into The Hague and secure the leading officials in the Dutch government, and in particular, take the official surrender of the country from Queen Wilhelmina herself. Von Sponeck had arrived himself at Valhaven Airport after its capture, dressed in full dress uniform for the task. But alas, the Dutch monarch was to disappoint him. She accepted an invitation from the British government instead to go to England and was evacuated by sea from Amsterdam harbour along with a very large supply of diamonds. The Dutch defenders in Rotterdam put up a strong resistance. They were joined by a small British contingent in the fight for the city. Before the final surrender, Rotterdam would be heavily damaged from the ground and especially from the air. The Luftwaffe had assembled 430 Ju-52s for Case Yellow, with the bulk of these being allocated to the attacks on Holland. Those seen in the top of this picture have just landed elements of the 22nd Division at Valhaven Airfield. But others landing on other bases were not so lucky. Heavy incoming fire caused great damage among the grounded trimotors. In an experience that was to prefigure that of Crete just over a year away, the vulnerability of transports attempting to land in the face of heavy enemy fire was clear to see. The Luftwaffe admitted to the loss of 40% of its entire Ju-52 fleet. Of the 162 recovered, 53 were repairable and 47 used for spares. The rest were written off for scrap, as was this example that was ripped apart by Dutch mortar fire as it was landing. Although the Dutch strongly resisted the Germans, they were overwhelmed by the enemy offensive. On the 13th, 14th, German ground forces had forced the Dutch army into retreating to the Vesting Holland. On the 14th, the Luftwaffe carried out its infamous bombing raid on Rotterdam. At 11:45 hours on the 15th, the Dutch laid down their arms after 4 days of fighting. Their surrender was accepted on behalf of the German government by General Jörg von Kukler. Paratroops applauded the panzer columns that swept past the positions they had captured 3 days before. The first large-scale parachute assault in history had been achieved. Like the fortress of Liège, which had the potential to delay the German advance across Belgium in 1914, so too in 1940 did the fortress of Ebenemael. Designed by the Belgians to fulfil the same purpose, it was regarded as being even stronger than the Maginot Line. It had to be taken by the Germans. It was Hitler who observed from photographs of the fortress that the top of it looked like a meadow. Why not use gliders to land directly on top of it? Student agreed. It was decided to attack the fortress from the air using a force of paratroops carried in a number of DFS 230 gliders. Carrying a maximum of 10 men, this small glider was ideal for the task of landing in a confined area. Oberleutnant Witzig led Granit, the first of four assault groups. Whilst Granit was tasked with the capture of the actual fortress, the other three groups, Eisen, Betten and Stahl, attacked the bridges. Early on the 10th of May, 41 DFS 230 gliders were hauled into the air by their Ju-52 tow planes from air bases around Cologne. They belonged to the Luftwaffe's Luftlandgeschwader 1, the world's first assault glider formation. Of these, 11 carried paratroopers tasked with capturing the fortress, and the others with securing surrounding bridges and holding the site until the arrival of ground forces. This map, prepared for and shown in the film of the storming of the fortress, made after the battle for the cinema in Germany, shows the approach taken by the gliders to Ebenemael. 5 minutes before the main German attack on Belgium, timed to begin at 05:25, the glider force swept down on the designated positions. Although the Belgian defenders were taken by surprise, a few anti-aircraft guns were able to open up but caused little damage. All the attackers came from the Koch storm detachment named after its commander. While the sappers landed their gliders on top of the fortress, the parachute company landed within range of their targets. Bridges that served the area in the immediate vicinity of the fortress. The bridges and the plan of attack for each were given their own names, which corresponded to those of the assault groups. The Veldwezel Bridge was targeted by the Stahl group, group, Eisen went for the Cannes Bridge and Bessen for the Vroonhoven Bridge. Of these three bridges, only that at Cannes could not be secured, the defenders reacting quickly enough to set off the preset explosive charges. This was unfortunate as the 51st Sapper Battalion, which was advancing with the ground forces, had been detailed to employ this bridge to relieve granite on the fortress once it had arrived. As this unit couldn't neutralise a casemate gun facing the Meuse River, it was unable to cross the river until the morning of the following day. In the period of training before the assault, the Pioneer Assault Group, commanded by Witzig, had employed sections of fortifications in the Sudetenland and at Gliwice in Poland. By the time of the actual attack, the routine had been rehearsed most extensively. 11 gliders had been allocated for the assault on granite, and 10 eventually arrived. Rapidly vacating their craft, the sappers rushed out onto the roof of the fortress and headed first for the anti-aircraft and infantry weapons. Thereafter, the team headed for their respective larger targets. The Belgian faith in the impregnability of their fortress was now dealt a quite literally shattering blow as the fort was subjected to the first employment of the new hollow charge explosive. 2.5 tons of explosive had been prepared for the assault on Eben Emal. 7 couplers were targeted with a new weapon. 5 exploded with devastating effect. By midday on the 11th, the defenders had had enough and surrendered. The reaction of the Belgians was incredulity that their fortress could have succumbed so easily. The effect of the hollow charge shells was studied by German engineers after the battle with great interest. The power of the new explosive was remarkable and saw the application of the principle of hollow charge to anti-tank weapons later in the war. In the short term, the success at Eben Emael served to propel the idea of airborne assault to the forefront of German military thinking. Not only would the intended invasion of Britain employ large numbers of paratroops, but it would also spawn a remarkable glider. Following the fall of France and the signing of the armistice, an ecstatic Führer visited Storm Detachment Koch. In a formal presentation, Hitler awarded the other ranks the Iron Cross First Class, whilst the officers in charge of the four groups each received the Knight's Cross. It is interesting that whilst Hitler took pride in the prowess of his airborne troops, he nevertheless retained a degree of scepticism about their use, appreciating that they could only succeed when they achieved surprise. It was Professor Willy Messerschmitt who was asked in October 1940 to design and produce the ultimate example of the Luftwaffe's faith in the idea of an unpowered glider to deliver air landing formations. While by that date Operation Sea Lion, the original plan for the invasion of Britain, had been called off, Hitler stated it was postponed and not abandoned. In the meantime, it would be necessary to design a new large glider for the proposed future invasion. Messerschmitt came up with his huge design, appropriately called the Gigant, within a very short space of time. Just 14 weeks after the contract had been issued, the first example was rolled out of the factory. The capacious fuselage was required to be able to carry a variety of loads. The intention was that it would be flown to the landing zone with men and equipment, able to sustain a bridgehead before reinforcement by the seaborne invasion forces. In addition to anti-tank guns and motorcycles, which could be carried in the lower section of the fuselage, the addition of an auxiliary deck would enable up to 200 troops to be carried as well. However, it was not lost on some Luftwaffe officers that carrying so many men in such an inherently vulnerable machine was holding a hostage to fortune. It was a primary requirement in the specification for the Gigant that it be able to transport armour to the battle zone. That shown being loaded into the hold of the glider is a Panzer 38T light tank, which weighed approximately 9.5 tons. The hold of the Gigant was more than adequate to carry two of these machines. Heavier armoured fighting vehicles, such as the Panzer IV medium tank or assault gun, weighing in excess of 20 tons, was also expected to be transportable by the Gigant. Other loads could include an 8-ton half-track and towed 88mm flat gun and other types of artillery pieces. quickly became apparent that the Gigant would be an extremely difficult glider to tow into the air. Little thought had been given when the specification was issued as to whether there existed a suitable tug for the plane, or even if it was available in sufficient numbers. To aid takeoff, it could be fitted with up to 2 8 30-second hydrogen peroxide rockets attached under the wings, with each delivering 1,103 pounds of thrust. One of the few aircraft available in Germany at the time of the Gigant's trials and which could function as a towing plane was the Junkers Ju-90 airliner. But even its four engines gave it barely enough power to tow the immense glider, and the use of the underwing rockets was mandatory when it first took the Gigant into the air in February 1941. Once airborne, the Gigant proved to be surprisingly stable, although heavy on the controls for the single pilot. Only a few modifications were needed. Dual controls were added to enable a second pilot to share the load. Even as the prototype was being tested, Gigants were emerging from the factories in large numbers. It soon became clear, however, that while the design was commendable, the idea that gave it birth had not been thought through. The famed German woman aviator Hanna Reich flew the type, and while accepting it was heavy on the controls, nevertheless said it flew quite well. She also raised the question of the Gigant's suitability as a genuine weapon of war. The Ju-90 symbolised the lack of clear thinking that spawned the Gigant. While superficially impressive, the Gigant was to all intents and purposes unworkable. At the time of the Gigant's flight in 1941, the Ju-90, which had been designed from the outset as a commercial airliner for Lufthansa, was the only aircraft capable of towing the Gigant into the air. We have already observed that it was underpowered for such a task, and even if it had been suitable, it was available in pitifully small numbers. Thus, the Luftwaffe cast around for improvisations to address this problem. Troika Schlepp employed three ME-110s to tow the Gigant in what was an extremely dangerous arrangement. It needed nearly 4,000 feet of runway to pull a fully loaded glider into the air. Not surprisingly, the 110 pilots described the process of towing a Gigant as hair-raising. Notwithstanding the obvious difficulties with the Gigant, the Luftwaffe persisted in searching for a suitable tow plane. It was Ernst Udet who suggested mating two Heinkel 111s together. The addition of a joining wing mounting a fifth engine gave this machine a most grotesque appearance. Nevertheless, the first prototype was delivered in late 1941, with eight built by the spring of 1942. Although it had to be equipped with rocket motors when towing the Gigant, it was very successful. Though once airborne, the HE-111Z had to maintain an airspeed of 137 miles an hour to keep the Gigant in level flight. Most employment of the Gigant occurred in the east. The failure of Barbarossa had obviated the need for an assault glider for an invasion of England that never happened. By 1942, the love affair with the assault glider had run its course. The glider variant of the Gigant received a new lease of life when it was fitted with six engines. In its new form and with a new designation, the ME-323, the Gigant provided the Luftwaffe with its largest transport aircraft. It rapidly became a familiar type to the Fallschirmjäger, who were frequently airlifted in large numbers over long distances, especially when serving as infantry on the Eastern Front. While the assault glider would assume a much smaller role in German thinking, the success achieved by them had been noted and developed by the Allied powers. It was on April the 6th, 1941, that German forces invaded Yugoslavia and Greece. The occupation of Greece arose from Hitler's desire to clear his southern flank before launching the invasion of Russia. British forces had arrived in the country in early March as London sought to honour the commitment to protect Greece's neutrality it had made in April 1939. It took less than a month for the Wehrmacht to defeat Greece and eject the British. Greece and the subsequent invasion of Crete is forever linked with the Fallschirmjäger as being the theatre in which they secured their greatest victory and incurred their highest ever operational losses. The first commitment of paratroops took place on April the 26th, when a large contingent was sent to secure a bridgehead over the Corinth Canal to cut the escape route of British forces retreating through Greece. 120 Ju-52s flying out of Bulgaria were employed to drop the paras and tow a number of gliders. Although the bridge was blown by British troops to prevent its capture, over the next 2 days the airborne unit secured the town of Corinth and took a sizable number of prisoners before ground forces arrived on the 28th. By the time German troops reached Athens on April the 27th, the British had succeeded in evacuating some 51,000 men by sea from the mainland and transporting them to Crete. Another 25,000 troops had been killed or taken prisoner. The Greeks themselves had surrendered some days before. The swastika now flew over the Parthenon. In the wake of the fall of Greece, there were many in the German High Command who advocated the rapid capture of Malta. This also would have been a major airborne operation. As events transpired, it was Crete rather than Malta that became the focus of their expertise. At first, Hitler was sceptical, stating that an airborne operation to capture Crete sounds all right, but I don't think it's practicable. As one of Hitler's most favoured commanders, it did not take long, however, for General Student, commander of the Fallschirmjäger arm, to convince him otherwise. Student laid before him a detailed and phased plan for the seizure of the island, which greatly appealed to the German leader. The value of Crete was not lost on Hitler. The island occupies a key strategic position in the centre of the eastern Mediterranean and has in Suda Bay, west of Carnia, which in 1941 was the island's capital, the Mediterranean's largest natural harbour. This was being employed by the Royal Navy as an important refueling base. The capture of the island would deprive the British of this base, deny them the Aegean, and threaten the convoy route between Malta and Alexandria. The Luftwaffe would gain 3 strategic air bases. The period late April and early May saw the arrival in Greece of the bulk of the Luftwaffe's 7th Flieger Division. The airlift was staged through bases in Hungary, Romania, and Bulgaria. During this period, when planning was being undertaken, many of the troops destined to take part in the forthcoming Crete operation were rested and prepared. They were made ready for what was to be, up to that time, the largest airborne operation ever undertaken. The intention to order a rapid invasion of Crete following on the heels of the Greek surrender had to be postponed as the bulk of the Junkers 52 fleet were returned to Germany for overhaul. Nearly all of the Ju-52 serving in the Transport Verband had been employed in the Balkan campaign and were in need of major servicing. Furthermore, such were the very poor road links into Greece that virtually all the fuel needed for the transports allocated to the operation had to be flown in by them in the days before the 20th of May. In essence, the German plan required that Student's men take and hold the vital points on the island within the first 24 hours and hold them until such time as they could be relieved by ground troops from 5th Mountain Division. The plan called for the air assault to be delivered in 2 waves. The first would arrive over Crete at dawn and would target Melem and Canea. A second, smaller wave was to be dropped in the early afternoon, and these would seize Retimo and Heraklion. The intention was for these 2 waves to link up as soon as possible before day's end. They would then prepare the way for elements of 5th Mountain Division to be airlifted into the captured airstrips on the following day. The rest of the mountain troops would make passage to the island by sea. The Germans had amassed no fewer than 500 transports and 75 gliders for the operation, with the Luftwaffe having secured total air superiority over the island for its supporting bombers, Stukas and fighters. By the 19th of May, the transport armada was dispersed over the seven airfields of Megara, Tanagra, Topolia, Dadian, Eleusis and Corinth. Supporting Luftwaffe units such as the Stukas operated out of Malai, Mycenae and the island of Scarpanto. Fulfilling the role of primary Luftwaffe transport throughout the conflict, the Ju-52 was the type employed for the paratroop assault on Crete. In this role, it normally carried 11 or 12 troops. Most personal weapons were normally carried in separate weapons containers that were also dropped by parachute. These were located, opened, and the weapons recovered after landing. While larger loads could be carried inside a Ju-52, heavier support weapons such as a 20mm light flat gun, 37mm anti-tank gun or motorcycle combination would be mounted on a jettisonable frame which was slung under the center section of the Ju-52. As for the men, they were regarded as elite infantry. By day's end on the 19th of May, the supporting bombers and fighters had all been armed, all the transports loaded and fueled. Last but not least were the 75 DFS 230 gliders to be towed to the island. With these, the 1st Air Assault Regiment would attack Merlim and Canea airfields. The paratroops nervously awaited the launch of Operation Mercury, the capture of Crete from the air. An hour and a half after the 1st Luftwaffe squadrons took to the air from their mainland Greek and island bases, British and Commonwealth defenders on Crete heard the approach of yet another of the daily early morning raids that they'd suffered since their arrival on the island. Today, however, would be different. On the seven airfields on which the armada of Ju-52s were parked, there was a buzz of excitement. Woken from their sleep by whistles and shouts across each base at 3:30 a.m., the paratroopers began their final preparations for this, the largest airborne operation ever mounted. The order to begin the operation came in shortly after 4 a.m. Tension was high as thousands of men of the first wave donned their jump smock and trousers, gloves and helmet. Protective knee pads were fitted, and most important of all, each man adjusted and checked their own and each other's RZ-1 parachutes. K-pop life jackets were worn by some. A veteran recalled how his unit CO addressed them, saying that Germany will be proud of her paratroops. I expect that each man will do his duty. The paratroop song could be heard wafting across a number of the fields. Rogue chimed the song. The first aircraft left Megara at 5 a.m. Significantly, Hitler had ordered that there be no coverage of Mercury during its execution. A measure perhaps of how uncertain he still remained as to its outcome. The film released to German cinemas after the battle, the bulk of which is seen here, gives no hint whatever of how perilously close to disaster the operation came, nor how high the casualties suffered by the Fallschirmjäger arm. General Student had been informed by German intelligence that there were just 5,000 enemy troops on the island. In fact, there were 32,000 British and Commonwealth troops and 8,000 Greek and irregular Cretan troops. Furthermore, unbeknown to the Germans, the first and most vital element in that equation had already been denied them. Through the cracking of Luftwaffe codes by the Ultra Organisation at Bletchley Park in England, the Allied commander, General Freiberg, was fully aware, even as the German assault force was moving its way to the island, that it was coming, the size of it, its intended targets, and times of arrival. In theory, the German assault should have been defeated. Troopers on board the Ju-52s made final preparations, their static lines between their teeth, the lumbering German tri-motors hauled into view over their drop zones. At Marlene, the German main target for the first wave assault, New Zealand troops abandoned their breakfast to watch the sight as the long line of transports came into view. From as far east to as far west as could be seen, from horizon to horizon came the planes. The first waves of paratroops began to jump. The spectacle was to herald a day of appalling losses for the Germans. The men of the 1st Assault Regiment arrived in their gliders at 7:15 p.m. and by day's end had suffered 50% casualties. Losses among the paratroop units was even higher. Landing on its New Zealanders after having been blown off course by strong winds, the 3rd Battalion had lost 400 dead out of 500 within 45 minutes. Many having been shot as they descended, described as like shooting ducks. You'd see one go limp and kind of straighten up with a jerk and then go limp again, and you knew he was done for. Nor did those dropping at Kanea and Heraklion suffer any less. Of the 136 men who got out of their gliders at Kanea, no less than 108 rapidly became casualties. By midday, other than the Tavranitis Bridge near Malemi, no other objective had been secured and casualties were severe. Surviving pockets of troops were pinned down by enemy fire and unable to advance towards their objectives. Many unit commanders had been killed, including Sussman, commander of the 1st Assault Division. So chaotic were conditions that no word of the progress of events had reached General Studant's headquarters in Greece, where the assumption was all was going well and with preparations being made for the second wave. The incoming JU-52s sweep across Athens as they return to base. The propaganda company cameramen who were on hand to film them proceeded to record the only damage to a German transport that was seen by the audiences in the homeland and elsewhere during the whole course of Operation Mercury. While the damage to this JU-52 includes the loss of an undercarriage leg, requiring a skillful crash landing by the pilot, there is no suggestion in any of the film that the whole operation was anything other than a complete success. The inference that casualties in both men and machines was negligible is clearly implied. Once down, the camera lingers for some moments on slight damage to the wing trailing edge of the Junkers, suggesting that the enemy opposition was light. The aircrew give an account of their experiences for the benefit of the camera and the ground crew, as the latter now set to in order to repair the aircraft. On this occasion, this JU-52 was ready to fly again in short order. Having refueled and taken on more paratroops, the JU-52s took off once more to deliver the second wave. These were to be dropped in order to capture the airfields at Retimo and Heraklion. Arriving over their targets at 3 p.m, the paras jumped into a situation every bit as difficult as for those who had dropped in the morning. At Retimo, 2nd Parachute Regiment dropped in an area held by Australian troops and were pinned down. At Heraklion, one company of the 1st Parachute Regiment was killed almost to a man. By day's end, the German situation was precarious. Facing catastrophe, Student decided to concentrate all his remaining assets on Malem and ordered General Ringel's Mountain Division airlifted in on the 21st. The mountain troops, who are seen here donning their KPOC life jackets, would have to brave landing on an airstrip still under fire from the remaining Allied artillery. Arrival was preceded by yet another para drop when, in the afternoon of the 21st of May, Student sent in his final two companies of Fallschirmjäger. They too shared a similar fate to those who had jumped before. On this occasion, they fell among Mari troops who dispatched many of them in short order. Nevertheless, Freiburg's failure to launch an all-out attack on the remnants of the German forces around Marlene during the previous night, allied to a mistaken decision which led to the capture by the paratroops of the all-important Hill 107 on the morning of the 21st, had considerably improved the situation of Studenz's men. Amid the wreckage of British and Greek aircraft, the Fallschirmjäger captured and consolidated their hold on the vital landing field at Marlene. Although the landing strip remained vulnerable to Allied artillery and machine gun fire, the field was now open for the landing of the 1st of Ringel's Mountain Division troops. Early in the afternoon, the 1st Ju-52 landed on the field through a hail of enemy machine gun fire. Within 2 hours, a line of transports was making the journey from Greece and had begun to offload the mountain troops. On film by the cameraman was the appalling destruction incurred by the Ju-52s in the process as they crash-landed, collided, or were destroyed by enemy fire. Failure of a New Zealand counterattack on the field led to the taking of the first Allied prisoners. The arrival of Ringel himself on the 22nd to take command led by the 23rd to Allied troops being pushed beyond the range of the airfield. 2,000 further troops were flown in. Thereafter, the Ju-52s could fly in unimpeded by enemy fire. General Student arrived on the island on the morning of the 25th. By that time, the situation for the Germans had improved markedly. The previous night, the troops of Marlamy had linked up with the survivors of the paradrop near Canea. The decisive battle for Crete was fought on the 25th when the Germans assaulted a blocking position held by New Zealand troops at Galatas between Marlamy and Canea. Although the Commonwealth troops scored a local victory, by the 26th they had been ousted. And that evening Freiburg signalled Egypt that, in his opinion, from the military point of view, our position here is hopeless. On the following day, the decision was taken to evacuate the island and the Allied troops began to retreat. Between the 27th and 29th of May, the German battle group pushed along the coast road and in the face of Allied delays, finally took Heraklion and Retimo. It was not until the 29th, however, that the Germans, having reached the southeastern corner of the island, realized that they had been in error in believing that the Allied troops had been retreating eastward. In fact, for the past 2 days, they had been moving south towards the designated point of evacuation at Sfakia. By the time they had made good on their error and captured the port and the remaining Allied troops therein on the 1st of June, about half had been evacuated. By day's end on the 1st, Crete was in German hands. Although victorious, the cost had been prohibitive. Of the 8,500 para and glider troops employed in the operation, 3,674 had been killed. As the Luftwaffe set about assessing its losses in the aftermath of the battle, the large number of damaged and wrecked Junkers 52s that littered the airfields at Malemi, Canea and Rathimon provided graphic testimony to the savagery of the fighting during the battle. Many of the transports at Malemi were hit by enemy artillery fire, with collisions between landing and parked aircraft accounting for the greatest percentage of the losses. So many went up in flames after landing that the whitish-grey ash of their burnt aluminium hung over the strip for days. This deadly attrition cost the transport Verband no less than 271 Ju-52s out of the 500 aircraft committed. Many of their experienced aircrew were also killed. This constituted to no less than 50% of all the transports involved and was, by the end of 1941, to have accounted for more than half of all the Ju-52s lost in that year. More importantly, such losses were to rob the Luftwaffe of a vital number of these invaluable transports at the start of the Wehrmacht's greatest challenge, the Russian campaign. Hitler was far from pleased with his Pyrrhic victory, and his perception sealed the fate of the paratroop arm for the remainder of the war. The day of the parachutist is over. The parachute arm is a surprise weapon, and without the element of surprise, there can be no future for airborne forces. Employment of the Fallschirmjäger in Russia was not long coming. The need for troops saw 7th Flieger Division initially deployed for operations around Leningrad in September 1941. By December, they had lost 3,000 dead and wounded. Employed by the paratroops were a number of specialised weapons developed for airborne use, such as this recoilless gun, developed by Rheinmetall in 75 and 105mm calibres. 1941 had also seen the deployment of smaller units of paratroop with Army Group Centre and South. The former saw paras used as infantry in the drive on Moscow between September and December. A larger contingent was deployed around Stalino in the heavy winter fighting from November 41 through to March 42. As around Leningrad and in company with all other German infantry formations in the east, losses were extremely high. Most of the film here, though, shows the operations of Fallschirmjäger Pioneer Abteilung 7, with 9th Army in the Rajev salient in front of Moscow between October 42 and March 43. The task of the formation was primarily that of constructing bunkers to aid the fixed defences. The salient had been the focus of very heavy fighting throughout 42 as the Soviets sought to destroy this cockpit from which they believed the Germans could launch a renewed offensive to take Moscow, which, at its nearest point to the Kremlin, was just 112 miles away. The salient acted as a breakwater throughout the summer of 42, with the Germans facing up to and wearing down a number of Soviet offensives. The battalion fought alongside the army formations throughout the harsh winter of 42-43 and took part in the carefully planned withdrawal from it, authorised by Hitler on February 6, 1943. The first paratroop unit to receive the call to prepare for service in North Africa in support of Rommel's Afrika Corps came from the Fallschirmjäger Lehr Battalion belonging to the 11th Flieger Corps stationed in Berlin in December 1941. Under the command of Major Buckhart, 612 men arrived in North Africa on the 9th of January and were then driven to the front, some 520 kilometres to the east, where they arrived and took up positions in the line on the 15th. This first deployment by a detachment of paratroops lasted some 3 months, the unit being withdrawn from the theatre at the end of March. The second appearance of the Fallschirmjäger in the Western Desert would be in greater strength and reflected very much upon the need for reinforcements for Rommel's forces. Rommel's request was sent via High Command headquarters, and they in their turn referred the request to General Student, who was ordered to provide a new Kampfergruppe of paratroops. The man chosen to lead this new formation was Major General Bernhard Ramke, who'd only volunteered for the Fallschirmjäger in 1940 at the age of 51. Ramke had acquired a formidable reputation for his actions in Crete, where he had taken command from the wounded General Meindl at Marlamy. He was awarded the Knight's Cross. He flew out to Africa in July 1942 for briefing. His brigade was organised into four battle groups. These fought as infantry formations with support from the 2nd Battalion of 7th Airborne Artillery Regiment, Paratroop Anti-Tank Company, Engineers and Signallers. The brigade was deployed midway in the German-Italian line at El Alamein and missed most of the heavy fighting in that battle. Thereafter isolated, the brigade conducted a forced march and only caught up with the retreating Afrika Corps on the 6th of November after having captured and used a British supply column. Even as Rommel's Afrika Corps was in full-scale retreat across the coast of North Africa towards Tunisia, a series of Allied landings took place in Algeria and Morocco in early November. While initially having to deal with the Vichy French forces in both countries, it was the Allied intention to drive rapidly eastward and take the Axis forces in pincer movement along with 8th Army. The 12th of November was significant in witnessing the first commitment of Allied paratroops to battle when British airborne forces were dropped to capture the airfield at Bone, to be followed some days later by the US 503rd Parachute Regiment, which was dropped at Uccle-les-Bains. By the 21st of November, Allied troops had reached Gafsa, which lay inside the border of Tunisia. While the advance of the Allied troops was greeted with elation, the farther they moved into Tunisia, the stronger Axis resistance became. Any prospect of rapid Allied victory now faded. The landings prompted a speedy reinforcement to the Axis bridgehead in Tunisia, including a number of paratroop units. By early April 1943, the noose was tightening around the bridgehead, with almost all of the harbours and airfields now under Allied control. In the final battles, Fallschirmjäger Regiment 5 lost more than 300 men. The Axis forces surrendered on the 9th of May. Whilst the fortunes of war had turned irredeemably against Germany, the last 2 years of the conflict would see the German paratroop arm acquire an even more formidable reputation on battlefields in Italy and France, at Monte Cassino and